Hi guys, this is Mauli Venkatakil and we are going to present now the audit of consolidation financial statements, right? These are the quick revision videos for CA final audit for November 2020 or May 21, right? Directly going to our topic, the topic is audit of consolidation financial statements. Before that, we'll just know two meanings. What is the definition of a subsidiary company and what is the definition of associate company, right? Coming to the definition of a subsidiary company, once again, so coming to the definition of a subsidiary company, there are two points in this particular definition thing. The first one is talking about the control, and second one is talking about the total voting power. The first point is if it controls the composition of board of directors, then it is said to be subsidiary, or the total voting power is more than 50%, then it is said to be a subsidiary. The 50% total voting power shall be checked either by its own or by other subsidiaries. For example, we'll consider here the definition of a control. What is a control? Appoint or remove or all or majority of directors. If a company is going to appoint or remove all or majority of the directors of a particular company, then this particular company is said to be a subsidiary of this company. For example, we'll consider here A Limited is there, and here B Limited is there, right? In this B Limited, there are directors A, B, C, and A Limited can control these three directors, can appoint directors in B Limited, or if they can remove directors in B Limited, that is either all or majority, then this B Limited is said to be subsidiary of A Limited, right? That is the first point. And coming to the second point, for example, here the same, considering the same A Limited thing, and here B Limited, right? And A Limited is holding 51% of total voting power, that is the share capital, shares of B Limited, then B Limited is said to be subsidiary to A Limited, and A Limited is a holding company, right? This is the particular thing regarding to the definition of a subsidiary company. There are two points. One is the control and composition of board of directors, and other is the more than 50% of total voting power, right? And coming to the next definition, that is the associate company definition. Right here also two points are there. The first important point is coming to the significant influence. What is the significant influence? See, if it has more than 20% of total voting power, then it is said to be significant influence. Then that particular company is said to be associate company to the company which is holding that 20% of voting power. It also includes JV, right? We are clear with these two definitions, and going to our main topic, that is our second point here, that is meaning and content of consolidation financial statements, right? We'll consider an example here. For example, this X Limited is a parent company, and A is a subsidiary, B is a subsidiary, C is the joint venture, and D is a associate, right? Then this X Limited is said to be parent company, and these A, B, C, D are said to be components, and these whole companies X along with these components are said to be as group companies, right? That is the structure of this chapter. And coming to this consolidation, the consolidation statements, consolidation financial statements will be prepared in the same format as adopted by the parent company. The format should be same as it read by the parent company, that is here in this example the X Limited. And also where the preparation and presentation of consolidation financial statements have been mentioned in AS 21 and Ind AS 110, right? These two standards deals with this preparation and presentation of consolidation financial statements. Coming to our third point, that is a section, that is a statutory point, section 129 subsection 3 of the Companies Act 2013. Here it says where a company has one or more subsidiaries or associates. We already discussed what is the definition of subsidiary and what is the definition of associate. Where, if any company is having one or more of these subsidiaries or associates, then that particular company shall prepare the consolidation financial statements in the same form and same manner with the applicable financial reporting framework, that is here accounting standards and schedule 3, right? This section 129 subsection 3 says as follows: if a company is having any subsidiary, one or more subsidiary or one or more associate, then the particular company shall prepare the CFS, right? That is the main thing. And also it states that along with that CFS, it also has to mention a separate statement which contains what? Which contains the salient features of what, the subsidiaries or the associates. Briefly, we can say the salient features of components, right? That salient features of a component shall be attached to the CFS in which form number? Form number AOC1, right? Form number AOC1. MCQ can be expected in this particular thing, right? And coming to that, here the central government may provide such rules. The central government may provide for such rules for this consolidation purpose. The central government can provide such rules, right? And coming to our, that is fourth point, the Rule 6 of the Companies Accounts Rules 2014. The Rule 6 says as follows. For example, if any consolidation financial statements is prepared, it should be prepared in accordance with the applicable financial reporting framework, as we already discussed in section 129, subsection 3. That has been mentioned in Rule 3. That is, applicable financial reporting framework is AS, that is accounting standards or Ind AS, and Schedule 3. Right? And coming to this rule, there are two provisions to this particular rule. What is the first provision? First provision is, for example, if a company is having one or more subsidiaries and the company has to prepare CFS according to section 129.3, and whereas if you see in the accounting standards, that particular company need not prepare that consolidation financial statement. See, if a company covered under section 129 subsection 3 required to prepare financial statement under what, accounting standards, right? Under these accounting standards, if it is required to prepare or not, we have to check. If it is yes, then the company has to comply with both the accounting standards plus the Schedule 3 requirements. And also, the company is not required to prepare the consolidation financial statements as per accounting standards, then the company is enough if it complies with the Schedule 3 requirements, right? That is our fourth point. We have already discussed that there are two procedures. The first procedure has been completed. And coming to the second procedure of this particular rule, that is the rule number 6, a company need not comply with these rules, meaning a company need not prepare the consolidation financial statements if, right? There are three particular conditions for a company need not prepare the CFS in accordance with this particular rule. There is a provision mentioned in this rule. What are the three points we'll discuss right now? It is a wholly owned subsidiary or partially owned subsidiary of other company, right? If a company is a wholly owned subsidiary or partially owned subsidiary of other company, then this wholly owned subsidiary or partially owned subsidiary company has given what? Has given intimation to whom? To the members, whether these members are entitled to vote or not, then that these members do not object to the company for not preparing CFS, right? What is the first point? If it is a wholly owned subsidiary company or a partially owned subsidiary company, and it has given the intimation to the members whether they are entitled to vote or not, then those particular members do not object for the preparation of CFS, right? That is the first condition to be satisfied for this exception of this rule. And coming to the second condition, there are unconditions are there, means the three conditions must be satisfied for this exception. What is the second condition? We'll see here. A company whose security is not listed, means the securities of the company is not listed in the stock exchange or not in the process of listing, means it should not be in the process of listing also, then in the stock exchange, whether or not in India or outside India, right? The company shares shall not be listed or shall not be in the process of listing, whether in India or outside India. That is the second point needs to be complied. And coming to the third point, unconditioned, very careful you have to be. And coming to the third point, it is its ultimate or intermediate holding company files CFS with the ROC in accordance with the accounting standards, right? This is the third condition. We will see the third condition with an example. Consider our company, that is our company as my company in this group structure. My company, ABC Limited is there, C Limited, A Limited, B Limited, right? Here we say ultimate. Who is the ultimate of our company? That is ABC Limited. Or who is the intermediary holding of our company? A Limited, right? What is this particular point saying is, if this ABC Limited or A Limited has prepared the consolidation financial statements and these consolidation financial statements has been filed with the ROC in accordance with the applicable accounting standards, then this particular my company need not prepare the CFS after complying with this remaining two conditions, right? These are the three conditions for this second closure to the exception. And coming to our fifth point, that is very important point, exceptions. For anything, there will be exceptions. There are two exceptions in accordance with the Accounting Standards 21 and Indian Accounting Standards 110, right? We'll see first AS 21, what is the exception? The exception is exclusion of a subsidiary. For example, A Limited is a parent company. It has B, C, D as components, and S is a subsidiary, B is a subsidiary, C is a subsidiary, and D is a subsidiary. D can be excluded, means there is an exception. D can be excluded only if particular conditions are satisfied. We'll see the particular conditions now. When the exclusion of subsidiary is allowed, right? As per AS 21, there is an exception to this particular CFS. The first condition is the control is intended to be temporary, means A Limited has acquired D Limited shares more than 50%, and this control, thus acquisition, is temporary, meaning that A Limited has an intention to sell the shares of D Limited in the near future, right? That is the first condition. The control should be temporary or operates under severe long-term restrictions, means D Limited is in such state that it has strong government implications, strong government rules, such that it cannot transfer its funds to its parent company. Then there is an exception to this particular consolidation. What are the two conditions? Temporary, intended to be temporary holding control, and second condition is severe long-term restrictions, right? If these two conditions are satisfied, then this particular subsidiary company can be excluded from the CFS preparation, right? If these conditions are satisfied, then what is the case? See, here the same example A, B, C, D are there, right? C, B and C are included in the CFS and D is not included. Then what happens to D? How we have to treat that D particular shares? We have to follow. How? If not included in CFS, how? What we have to do? We have to do with that Accounting Standards 13 and respective Ind AS. Accounting Standards 13 deals with the investments, right? In particular investments, we have to account it shares of that particular holding in D company. We have to account as per AS 13 as investments, short-term investments, current investments or non-current investments based on the period of holding. Right? And also we have to check the reasons for not consolidation of subsidiary. The reasons also shall be stated in that consolidation financial statement, because the reasons are the two conditions, the two points, temporary or severe long-term restrictions. These two points will be stated in the consolidation financial statements if a particular subsidiary is excluded, right? Note, there is a note point here that is very important point. This particular exception thing is given in under AS 21 but not in AS 110, meaning the CFS of a subsidiary, the consolidation of a subsidiary, is mandatory in AS. There is no such kind of exception given in this particular thing, right? Coming to the exception of Ind AS 110, what is the exception? Investment in entities not to consolidate, means if a particular company is an investment entity, then it is not required to consolidate its subsidiaries or associates or joint venture. When it is not required to consolidate, if it is an investment entity, we will see the definition of the investment entity, right? What it has to do if it has not complied with that particular thing, that is, if it is not required to prepare the CFS, then what it has to do, what that investment company has to do? It should measure the investment at fair value through profit and loss account with Ind AS 109, that is our financial instruments. If you go to our FR syllabus, one of the most important chapter in FR, the financial instruments, if we have done that chapter, then we will clearly know what is the fair value through profit and loss account and what is the fair value through OCI, other comprehensive income. There we can learn that particular thing. Means here the investment shall be accounted through fair value through FVT P&L, right? Through that it has to be accounted as per 109. See, we'll see the definition of investment, then we'll go to that however condition. The definition of investment company is, there are three points. It should obtain funds from the investors for providing investment management services. If you see this investment management services, somewhere we have had this investment management services, right? In our Companies Act, section 144 deals with the prohibited services that an auditor shall not perform. In that particular thing, this investment services, management services is there. That point can be considered here. And the second point for the definition of investment entity is, it commits to investor, it comes to investor that its main business is capital appreciation or interest generation, interest income generation. It has to come to that his business is only for capital appreciation or interest income. And the third condition, third point for the definition is all investments measured, all investments substantially. Substantially, all investments of the investment entity has to be measured at fair value. This is the definition of investment entity. If any particular company is falling under this particular thing, investment entity definition, then that company need not prepare CFS as per Ind AS 110. Right? We have missed one point here. That is a however point. We'll consider an example here. Here A Limited is a parent company and AX Limited we assume. AX Limited and A Limited is a subsidiary, B Limited is a subsidiary, and A Limited is not an investment company and B Limited, see A Limited is an investment company and B Limited is not an investment company and A Limited has also C Limited subsidiary and D Limited subsidiary. Then whether this A Limited has to prepare CFS or not is a question here. Right? For that reason we have to check whether this A Limited is an investment entity or not. If A Limited is an investment entity and satisfies all the three conditions, then this particular exception will apply. Then AX Limited need not prepare that CFS. If this AX Limited is not an investment entity, then it has to prepare consolidation financial statements for this entire structure. A Limited, B Limited, C Limited, D Limited. Even though A Limited is an investment company, the AX Limited has to prepare consolidation financial statements considering A Limited and also through its investment, that is C Limited and D Limited. This is one point here, needs to be very careful in this particular point. And coming to our the sixth point, that is the responsibilities of parent company and responsibilities of auditors of CFS. We'll see the responsibilities of parent company. Right? Identify. We have to identify components, related party transactions, segments. We have to identify three things. What are the components, means what are the subsidiaries, associate, joint venture, and what are the related party transactions, and what are the segment reporting, if any segment reporting is required in accordance with AS 17. Those things we have to identify for segment reporting purpose. And also we have to obtain accurate and complete information from components, means the first point is identification and second point is obtaining information. And the third point is making appropriate consolidation adjustments, means we have to make the appropriate consolidation adjustments for the consolidation purpose of this particular group companies. And the fourth point is harmonization of accounting policies and framework. There may be a case that one company is following a different accounting policy and another company is following different accounting policy, then we have to harmonize those accounting policies for the consolidation purpose. And also gap conversion. For example, there is a one company A Limited and B Limited, C Limited. A Limited is following Indian gap and B Limited is in France, that is German, France gap it is following. And C Limited is Germany gap it is following. Then this gap, that is generally accepted accounting principles, needs to be converted in our Indian accounting standards. Then the consolidation shall be taken place. What are the responsibilities of parent company? The responsibilities of parent company is identifying components, identifying related party transactions, identifying segments, and obtain accurate and complete information, making appropriate consolidation adjustments, harmonizing the accounting policies, gap conversion. There are some extra points for this responsibilities of parent company. There are, see, it can issue instructions to the components based upon the parent requirement. It can issue instructions and also it can issue the accounting policies which they can follow, and also the disclosure requirements what they have to make, and also the reporting timetable and so many things the parent company can provide, can give to the their particular components, and can ask them to follow these particular directions issued by the parent company. These are the responsibilities of parent company. Coming to the responsibilities of our auditor, our chartered accountant, right, our chartered accountant, he should satisfy himself that these consolidation financial statements are prepared in accordance with the applicable financial reporting framework, that is AFRF, that is AS and Schedule 3. We have already seen this in our section 129 subsection 3, the same thing he is saying. But auditor has to satisfy himself that this CFS has been prepared in this particular AFRF. That is the first responsibility of an auditor. And the second responsibility is the auditor has to check the true and fair value of this CFS. The first is to satisfy himself, and the second is the true and fair view. The third is our inquiry 143, subsection 1 and reporting 143 subsection 3 and other points, right? These are the four points we can write if the question is asked. But the first, satisfy himself, true and fair view, 143.1, 143.3, right? Coming to our seventh point. So far we have discussed half of this chapter, and coming to the seventh point, the planning stage. We are at the planning of the audit of CFA, that is consolidation financial statement. Before planning anything, first we have to understand the group structure, group-wide controls, and the IT assessment we have to make. We have to understand the group structure, how these companies like year A is there, year B is there, year C is there, how the structure is there, the structure and group-wide controls and the IT environment, this particular structure we have to understand. And coming to this next point is also based on the understanding what, understanding accounting policies of this parent company and the components, these accounting policies, it has to understand, and the consolidation process, how this parent company is following the consolidation process, that point needs to be understood for planning of an audit of CFS. And also if any subsidiaries is having under the foreign component, then the financial statements will be according to the foreign, right? Foreign, that translation shall be done. For example, here D is in Germany, then the financial statement may be in different language, those language financial statement should be translated to the certified English language, right? That thing needs to be the plan before planning the audit we have to check. And coming to the next, the nature and timing extent of audit we have to determine, and the risk of material assessment misstatements, assessment of risk of material misstatement shall be done before the audit. These are the three points. And coming to that, if for example there are so many companies that one auditor cannot do all audit, if there are component auditors, then whether this particular principal auditor who is consolidation financial statements has to consider this component auditor's work also, that thing is defined in our standard requirement SC 600, considering the work of other auditor, that is mostly the branch auditors, and coordinating the work in that particular audit. There are 5 to 6 members, the principal auditor will be there, the manager will be there, the article assistants will be there, the work shall be coordinated in between them. And coming to our eighth point, that is the audit procedure in auditing consolidation financial statements. The seventh point is relating to the planning, and the eighth point is audit procedures in auditing consolidation financial statements, right? We'll see. First, before going to the audit procedure, what we have to give, we have to obtain the list of subsidiaries and joint ventures including the CFS from whom, from the management. We have to obtain the list of the subsidiaries, associate, joint ventures from the management which have been included in CFS. Then we have obtained the list. Then what we have to do, we have to review the list, right? First is obtain the list, second review the list, and third verify whether this all particular subsidiaries are included or not, and the fourth one is the completeness of information provided by the management, right? That point is to verify. First we have to obtain, review, verify, then the completeness of information. And the fifth point is any changes in shareholding compared to the last audit, any change in the shareholding, that point needs to be part of audit procedure. And the sixth point is auditing adjustment, that is the consolidation adjustment shall be done, right? And coming to the completeness of information, how the auditor is going to verify whether the completeness of the information provided by the management is correct or not, right? The auditor has to verify these following things. He has to review, the auditor has to review the working papers of the previous, means if auditor is the same auditor, he has to review the working papers of the prior years for known subsidiaries. In the prior years, the subsidiaries will be there, right? These subsidiaries are there in the current year or not, or any changes is there or not. That thing auditor has to do by reviewing the working papers of prior years. And also the second thing auditor can do is, auditor can review the parent procedures for identification. How this particular company is identifying its subsidiaries, its associates, and its joint ventures, and it is including these companies in the consolidation. That procedure auditor has to identify, and he can find some mistakes, right, if any. And also the auditor has to review the investment made by this particular company, because through investment only we can say whether it is a subsidiary company or associate company. And the fourth point is joint venture agreements. If this particular company has entered into any joint venture agreement, that point has to be reviewed. And next one is statutory records, the section 186. By seeing these things, the auditor can see whether the information provided to the management is complete or not, right? And coming to our ninth point, this is very one important point, that is a special consideration in case of entities controlling the composition of board of directors. Right, this point has already been covered. It is a subsidiary definition. First point we have discussed in the first starting, right? The control thing, control over point. In this control, we have said the majority and all of the directors can be removed. Then that particular company is said to be subsidiary, right? The same thing has been mentioned here. If the ownership is not necessary for control, means ownership is not necessary, we can control indirectly also a company. Control may be exercised by controlling the composition of board of directors, as already we have discussed this point in subsidiary company definition, right? And we can say, we can have any here on example. Consider A Limited is a B Limited, and B Limited has board of directors B, C, D, E, and A Limited has investment of 10% of voting power, and A Limited can control the board of directors, that is control the composition of board of directors. Then practically by seeing the definition, you cannot say what is a subsidiary company limit 50%, what is the associate company 20%, you cannot say. But here there is an indirect control, then also this particular B Limited is said to be subsidiary, and A Limited has to consider B Limited for the consolidation purpose. See, the consolidation of A Limited and B Limited, parent component required or not? Yes, it is required to be done. And coming to the general procedures, means how the auditor has to identify whether this indirect control is there or not, he has to perform general audit procedures auditor has to follow to check this above, whether there is an indirect control or not. And auditor has to verify, for this purpose auditor has to verify the board minutes. Okay, by verifying the board minutes, in the minutes everything will be noted, right, as per section 118 board minutes. This particular thing shall be maintained, minutes book shall be maintained, and this particular minutes everything has been what happened in the meeting is maintained. Auditor, by verifying that thing, he can know whether there is an indirect control on this particular board. And also auditor has to verify the shareholder agreement by parent company, technology know-how agreements, and these particular things auditor has to verify this particular holding, whether they have indirect control or not. And auditor has to use his professional judgment, right? And coming to our 10th point, right? 10th point is auditor's duties in case of the exclusion of subsidiary. We have already discussed this exclusion of subsidiary in our exception to AS 21. There are 2 points, temporary and long-term civil restrictions. First auditor has to see the reasons, whether these particular reasons for the exclusion of subsidiary is falling under these particular two things or not. Temporary control, long-term severe restrictions. And the second thing is, if it is a temporary, then the auditor has to check the intention, subsequent disposal, and it has to follow. The auditor has to check whether the company is following AS 13 or not. Right? And coming to section 129.3, we have already discussed that if it is not required to prepare CFS as per accounting standards, then it is well enough the company to comply with schedule 3. The same point is mentioned here. One note point is, no such exception is given under Ind AS 10. This is a very simple question we can write. And coming to this 11th point, right, the management representations. This management representation, we have a particular separate standard for this, that is SA 580, right? And whose responsibilities is CFS. The consolidation financial statements preparation is the responsibilities of whom? The management, right? That is the first point, that the management has to give written representation to the auditor. And also the material matters relating to particular CFS, the management has to give representation. What representation management will give? The representation will be the responsibilities of the parent company. The same thing is here. Completeness of components, identification of reportable segments, identification of related party and related transactions, appropriateness of CFS judgments. These are the same similar points of responsibilities of parent, right? Responsibilities of parent company. And coming to our 12th point, relevance of SA 600. There is a previous question in this particular thing. A question has been asked in our previous exam paper. The question says as follows: state the relevance of SA 600 in accordance with the audit of consolidation financial statements. This question has been written in particular thing. We'll just see what the suggestions are given by the ICA. If the principal auditor decides to use the work of another auditor, he has to, his requirement, basic requirements, he has to comply with this requirements of SSCS 600. And even though the question is asked about the SSCS 600, but the suggestion answer states mainly around the topic, revolves around the topic materiality level. The auditor has to see the group materiality level to be decided. The auditor has to decide the group materiality level, and the auditor has to decide this particular group materiality level for assessment of appropriateness of adjustments, right? If any adjustments are there, whether that adjustments are appropriate based on that group materiality level decided by the auditor, he has to check. And also, this group materiality level decided by the auditor shall be used for decide whether this particular any component is material or not, right? Based on that, for example, consider here an example: A limited is there, B limited, C limited, D limited, right? Auditor of CFS has put some materiality of 20%, right? Here it is 25%, here it is 26%, here it is 19%. Then it is immaterial based on this group materiality level. The same point has been discussed here. And also the observation, this is very important point, MCQ is expected. What is the point? Based on the observations of the component auditor, means what are the observations given by the component auditor, that is other auditor, on that basis our principal auditor has modified the report, then such observations shall be stated in SA 705, or modification standard. And based on the observation of component auditor, the other auditor is not modifying his report, that means the principal auditor is not modifying his report, then such particular thing shall be given in emphasis of matter paragraph as per 706. This is important, emphasis of matter paragraph, right? And coming to our last but one point, 13th point, right? We have one more point, 13th point. You can see here, 13. Consolidation adjustments. What are the consolidation adjustments classified? 2 points: current period consolidation adjustments and permanent consolidation adjustments, right? What is the meaning of current period consolidation adjustments? The meaning is they are every year adjustments are there in the accounting period. Permanent adjustments are only once, mostly first occasion or subsequent occasion. If there is any change in this particular shareholding, then these permanent adjustments will be there. What are the two types of permanent consolidation adjustments? That is the determination of goodwill or capital reserve and the amount of equity attributable to the minority. These are the two permanent consolidation adjustments. Coming to the current period consolidation adjustment, there are so many points. The first point is intra-group interest paid, profits, indebtedness. 3 points: intra-group interest, profits, indebtedness. And the second one is harmonizing of accounting policies of parent company and component. Third point is subsequent events. If there is any subsequent events, the subsequent events can be classified as adjustments events and non-adjustments events, right? What are subsequent events? From this balance sheet date of the CFS and the date of auditor report, if any transactions has happened and those transactions are subsequent events, then those transactions can be divided into two types: adjusting and non-adjusting. This particular thing is a current period adjustments. If it is adjustment, then that effect shall be given to the balance sheet date. If it is non-adjustment, then such effect shall be ignored, right? And the next one is the gap conversion. The same thing, if any foreign component is there, the gap can be converted. Next, current period is movement in equity attributable to the minority, right? Since the date of acquisition, if any movement is there, that point is also current period adjustments. Deferred tax adjustments to the temporary differences, timing differences, that is also in a temporary current period adjustment. And different balance sheet dates, significant transactions, we'll see this here. What is the different balance sheet date? Balance sheet of component and auditor report. There may be a situation that A limited, B limited, C limited. A limited balance sheet is 31 March, that is March, and B limited is here 31st April, right? Then these are different balance sheet dates. These can be consolidated. The auditor has to check whether there have any significant transaction between the audit report and the date of balance sheet of component. Those points should be considered. These are the current period adjustments, right? What are the current period adjustments? Intra-group transactions, interest, profits, indebtedness, harmonization of accounting policies, subsequent events, gap conversion, movements in equity, deferred tax adjustments, different balance sheet dates, right? These are the current period adjustments. If the question is asked, we can write this, and the verification of the same, verify this, verify this, verify this, we can write like this. And coming to the verification points of permanent consolidation adjustments. What are the verification points? First, we have to check whether these adjustments have been properly done or not, appropriate done or not. Second, we have to consider the pre-acquisition reserve. Pre-acquisition is having to be determined and properly allocated or not. Because this has very importance based on that on which date the acquisition has been taken place, and such reserves distribution and allocation shall be made. And coming to the next, the auditor has to verify subsequent acquisition. If any subsequent acquisition are there, then the second point will change, that is a minority interest attributable will change. And for example, if there are A Limited, B, C, D, in one particular case goodwill arises, in this case capital reserve, this case goodwill, the company can show as a net figure. That point has been said here. The net goodwill or capital reserve may be permitted if the particular accounting financial reporting framework is allowing that. Whereas in case of the CFS, in case in the notes to the CFS, we have to show differently for B, C, D, goodwill, capital reserve, goodwill, right? This thing needs to be shown separately in a notes to account. That is the main point here. And coming to our last point, that is reporting considerations. There are 5 cases for reporting considerations, particular CFS. For the first case, the present auditor is auditor of all components. Second case is the parent auditor is not an auditor of all components. The third point is a different accounting framework of parent and components. Fourth point is a different auditing framework. Fifth point is components unaudited. We'll discuss one by one. If the parent auditor and parent auditor is same for the components, then the auditor, what is the reporting requirement? What are the reporting considerations? He has to consider true and fair view of the consolidation financial statements, consolidated profit and loss account, consolidated cash flow statements. And yes, also all relevant accounting units are followed or not. If there are any deviations, such deviations shall be reported with reasons, right? For the 2 points, true and fair view and deviations. Coming to this, parent auditor is different from the auditor of components. He has to follow SA 600 as already discussed. If decides to use the work of the other auditor, if the principal auditor decides to use the work of another auditor, this is important here, then that reference shall be given in the auditor report. Means I am using this particular auditor's work and I am referring this here in my report. The reference shall be as a portion of financial statements audited by other auditor, right? How the reference shall be, like this much percentage of assets, liabilities, expenditure, income are not audited by me but audited by some other auditor and I am relying on his report. That thing will be reported in our auditor report. And the reference, if just reference given, that doesn't mean that it is a qualification. It is just a divided responsibility that shall be taken care here. And coming to the different accounting framework, we have 2 options. If the accounting framework of parent company and component company is different, what are the 2 options we'll discuss here? The first option is the parent company has to convert the financial statements of the component, then the auditor will verify these conversion done by the parent company, whether it is appropriate for the CFS purpose or not. The second option is the parent company will send the group accounting manual. Group accounting manual, GAM, very important term. Group accounting manual will send by the parent auditor, parent company to the components, then the components will do this thing, accounting, and that particular accounting will be audited by the local component auditors. Then our parent auditor has to follow SA 600. These are the 2 options if that is accounting framework is different. If the auditing framework is different, the gap in India is different from gap in Germany, gap in France, right? If that is generally auditing principles, accepting principles, whether there, the main thing is we have to check the consistency, rely and refer. In order to rely and refer on the auditing framework, we have to see the consistency. If there's a difference, the components of financial statements are audited under different frame, audited under the different audit framework than that in India, that is a parent, then these particular components shall be again audited in our Indian GAAP. This is the point. And what is the 5th point? If the components are unaudited, right, we have to consider this unaudited components and the possible modifications to the report. The possible modifications we have to check. This is required because it has not obtained the sufficient and appropriate evidence on the consolidation balances. There are A, B, C, D subsidiaries, and AX is the parent company. A Limited is audited, B Limited also, C Limited is unaudited, right? it has huge figures. These to be consolidated at one place. In this particular D portion also is red. For this D particular portion, we have not obtained the sufficient and appropriate audit evidence. That is the audit report we have not obtained. For that, for this effect, there is any possible modifications are there or not, we have to check. Right? That is a possible modification. That is the fifth point. And both qualitative and quantitative aspects shall be considered and reporting shall be made in accordance with SA 705. Right? Up to this, everyone covers. This 14th point is important because this has been given only in our study material. We will just have a look what is this 14th point. Other points. Change method of depreciation is an accounting estimate, not an accounting policy. That is WTV to SLM is an accounting estimate, not an accounting policy. Company accounts. The company accounts allows component depreciation is mandatory. Whereas IT Act, we have a block-wise depreciation. For companies, the depreciation shall be component. These are the particular other points. And coming to the next B point. Not everything in the notes of standalone financial statements shall be disclosed as notes in CFS. Right? There are A, B, C, D. These all companies will have notes in their SFS. All these notes shall not be formed part of notes in CFS. The same thing has been shared through MC Circular. Only the relevant notes that are relevant shall be given. Right? The relevant notes shall be given. The same thing has been shared in our AX21 also says the same. The auditor has to verify the notes required by accounting standards for true and fair of CFS have been included or not, and also additional statutory information disclosed in SFS of parent company and component which is having bearing in true and fair of CFS shall be disclosed. These two points shall be disclosed in notes to CFS. Right? The Schedule 3 also says the same thing, should be disclosed separately for both parent company and component. Right? The Schedule 3 says that if in CFS these three points will be disclosed separately. What are the three points? Amount of net assets, the amount shall be given, and percentage of as a consolidated amount shall be given. The amount of share in P&L account shall be given, and percentage shall be given. The amount of OCA shall be given, and percentage shall be given as conso. These three points shall be given separately for parent company and component company in accordance with Schedule 3. It is a requirement of Schedule 3. Right. And coming to the C point and 14th point, the info giving separate financial statements of parent company and component company in CFS, right, examples need not be given. We already said that all the information in the CFS need not be given in SFS. State some examples. We have some examples here. Right. In CFS, the sources for which the bonus shares are issued has been given in SFS. This thing shall not be given in CFS. There is a consolidated financial statement. SFS is standalone financial statements. And the second point is disclosure of unutilized monies out of issue. This also given in SFS, need not be given in CFS. Third point is disclosure required under MSMED Act, that is Micro Small Medium Enterprise Development Act 2006. If any disclosure is required in this particular thing, has been given in SFS, need not be given in CFS. And the fourth point is value of import calculated in CIF basis, that is a cost, insurance, freight basis, raw materials, spare parts, capital goods. This given in CFS, not required in CFS. If it is given in SFS, not required in CFS. Fifth point is expenditure in foreign currency, royalty, know-how, professional fees, interest. This particular thing shall not be given in CFS if it is given in SFS. And sixth point is value of imported, both indigenous and imported, and their respective percentage, that is raw materials, spare parts, capital goods. This also shall be not given in CFS. Earnings in foreign exchange. What are the earnings we have made in export of goods, FOB basis, royalty, know-how, profit and loss account, fees, interest, dividend, other income. Not be given in CFS. Right. And coming to our eighth point, the last point, that is amount remitted in foreign currency. If any amount is remitted to the foreign in foreign currency, particular dividend, then the non-resident shareholders, number of shares held and year of dividend we will give in SFS, right? If it is given in SFS, then need not be given in CFS. These are the following eight examples. which are not required to be given in CFS. I think that's it all for now. Thank you so much for watching. Please subscribe, like, share and comment of your queries. If any, we'll try to resolve them. Thank you so much once again.